What if I told you that IBM is controlling what you see on your Linux screen right now? That would be the same IBM that sold punch card machines to some fascists that you might have heard of in the 1930s. Their machines, which they leased, were a pretty significant source of revenue for IBM in the 30s and in the 40s, and helped with things like organizing train schedules to death camps and tracking prisoner numbers. Now, through their subsidiary, Red Hat, a $34 billion company that essentially runs Enterprise Linux, they have just digitally assassinated a developer for creating an alternative to their preferred technology. Ubuntu followed suit and killed support for the display system that's been running Linux desktops since the 1980s. Your open source desktop isn't really as open as you might think. And the proof basically of that was made evident on June 6th of 2025. Now, Enterprise Linux, for those of you that are unfamiliar with what that actually is, basically means the boring, expensive version that banks and Fortune 500 companies pay thousands of dollars for because they need guaranteed support, certified software compatibility, and someone to sue when things break, which happens in Linux. Unlike Arch or Mint, when you own it, it's inevitably going to break, right? Like, something's going to get messed up while you try to spend 2 hours trying to rice your desktop. Quick message. Metux, if you're watching this, please, under no circumstances should you think that any tech giant wants to partner with you in order to make the project better. Seriously, skip to the embrace, extend, and extinguish part of this video to see what I actually mean if you're pressed for time. Anyways, today we're going to be talking about XLibre, the rebel fork, if you will, that was announced on June 6th of 2025, and why the software controlling your system might actually be the biggest security hole that you never knew existed. Every single window, click, and keystroke that's on your Linux machine passes through something called a display server. Now, think of it as like an air traffic controller for your screen, managing where windows go, who gets the keyboard input, and which app sees what. For decades, that very controller has been Xorg. And right now, the Linux world is watching it die because corporations decided that it should. So when the developer Metux saw Red Hat, which again is the multi-billion dollar IBM subsidiary that controls huge chunks of Linux development, systematically killing Xorg in order to push their preferred replacement, he did what any kind of self-respecting hacker would do, and he forked the entire project and called it XLibre. Within 24 hours, Red Hat employees deleted his account, purged his code, did all his contributions, and wiped 140 raw merge requests from existence at exactly 9:47 a.m. on June 6th. Now, these are obviously totally sane and rational people he's dealing with. They basically unpersoned him in Soviet style, except instead of like airbrushing him out of photos, they git purged him from existence. And this goes way deeper than code drama. We're talking about who controls your actual desktop, who decides your security model, and whether corporations get to dictate how you use your computer. So let me break down the actual three players that are in this war, because understanding them is important to really understanding why this even matters. Xorg has been managing Linux displays since the 1980s. Picture a middle manager who knows everyone's business. Every app can see what other apps are actually doing. Any program can read your keystrokes. And screen recording works because everything is wide open. It's great for functionality, but it's really bad for security. Xorg treats your desktop like 1980s office where everyone shares the same filing cabinet and nobody locks their desk drawers. And for those of you asking, no, I don't remember. Like, I'm not actually that old where I remember those days, despite the white in the beard. That's not caused from age, but rather from stress. So, Now, I was born in 1985, just in case you're wondering. But in 1995, they were still doing the same thing. Like, that said, and some offices still do it to this day. But anyways, that said, I had to actually give a shout out to the 80s because, yeah, they were underrated, in my opinion. Anyways, I digress. Wayland is the corporate-approved replacement for Xorg. Now, it started in 2008 as a open-source project. It was MIT-licensed, and it was primarily developed by Red Hat employees and Collabra contractors. Built from scratch in C with security in mind, it locks basically everything down really tight. Each app lives in its own bubble, which makes it obviously completely unable to spy on others. Screen recording requires permission through portals. Keyloggers can't function properly. Normally, that's what I'd be telling you to go with. But you realize that like half of your actual tools stop working. Kind of an issue. Remember the sliding scale with functionality and convenience on one side and security on the other side? Well, for example, OBS requires special builds and losses of some features like global hotkeys. Additionally, ShareX is not available. Even something as stupid as simple screen recorder is broken, and using FFmpeg for screen capture is challenging without jumping through hoops. Discord screen sharing breaks, but who cares about Discord since Discord harvests all your data anyways. TeamViewer, which again, another closed source trash app, and AnyDesk barely even function. Again, both are trash in comparison to RustDesk, in my opinion. Shout out to CWade12C for that suggestion years ago, but that also has its own issues as well. And forget about using X.tool, AutoKey, or X11 automation tools that power users have actually relied on for decades. KDE Connect, its remote input breaks and barrier and synergy for sharing keyboards between computers becomes a mess. And tools like Screen Copy for Android screen mirroring need workarounds. So if you want to do, say, gaming through Wine or Proton, then prepare for input lag and broken full screen modes, which we all know gamers love playing competitive FPS games in windowed mode on their $2,000 monitors. VR is basically dead on Wayland, and OpenXR implementations are still catching up. Remote desktop becomes a nightmare, X11 forwarding over SSH, which sysadmins have used since the dawn of time, basically, just doesn't exist. VNC even requires specific Wayland-compatible servers to actually be able to run. And even then, half the features actually break. Then you have accessibility tools that break. Things for like blind users that depend on things like Orca screen readers have really reduced functionality in Wayland. The entire ecosystem of X11 tools, which is built over 40 years, basically gets thrown into the trash. So this raises the question, is there anything that's actually good about it? And I would say yes. For example, the reference implementation. Weston is only about 50,000 lines compared to Xorg's 1.5 million. But efficiency comes at the cost of features people actually use. So who cares? It's like building a super secure bank vault and forgetting to add the door and then telling everyone that they were using doors wrong anyway. XLibre is the middle finger to corporate control. And because of that, it's the one that I like the best. Obviously, if you're a regular viewer of this channel, you probably could have guessed that. It was forked on June 6, 2025, and it takes Xorg's code base and promises to modernize it without breaking everything. The project claims they'll fix the security issues while keeping the functionality, and that makes Linux actually useful for professionals. The GitHub repository already shows active development with branches for code cleanup and driver compatibility testing. XLibre explicitly states that no big tech, no subsidiaries, and no DEI in their announcement, kind of positioning themselves as a development based purely on technical merit. Imagine that. most of the web browsers out there don't follow this simple thing. Like, really, at the end of the day, with privacy, that's all we want. We want to be left alone. And overall, I try to keep the politics off this channel because by default, I consider them to be super toxic in general. But ripping things like race baiting and gender roles and all the other nonsense out and just caring about the software, to me, is a massive win. Like, I just want my software to work and be secure. I don't care about, like, what your pronouns are or if you're a furry. Like, good for you. But, like, what actually matters to me is those things, like, that it actually works and it's secure. Metux contributed 64% of Xorg's commits in 2024, which means this dude solo basically carried the entire project on his back while Red Hat and other corporate contributors totally abandoned it. That alone tells me that this dude is an absolute workhorse. The timing is definitely not coincidental either. Ubuntu announced that they're dropping Xorg support for 25.10 just 3 days after it was announced. Major distros are actually falling in line, pushing users towards Wayland, whether they like it or not. And according to data from June of 2025, Fedora already defaults to Wayland, GNOME is removing X11 session options, and KDE is following suit. This kind of coordinated shift happened within a single week of the forks announcement. So 1 week, multiple independent projects all moving the same direction. Are you telling me if that's a coincidence? I'd definitely like to know your opinions in the comments. Xorg's security model is fundamentally broken and shattered for modern threats. Any application can keylog your passwords, screenshot your banking sessions, or inject input into other windows. Malware on Xorg has godlike powers over your desktop. Running Xorg in 2025 is kind of like leaving your house keys under the doormat and putting a sign up that tells people because that's how grandpa did it. Like, the only difference would be that grandpa's house didn't have Russian hackers is trying to steal his crypto wallet. And Wayland fixes these kind of holes by implementing proper isolation. So credit to them for that. But applications can't spy on each other for that reason. Screen capture requires explicit permission, and input handling stays locked down for people like journalists and hostile states, activists under surveillance, or anyone handling like really sensitive data. Wayland provides actual security boundaries, so it does have use cases, but Wayland breaks critical workflows, and not really by accident, but by design. The security comes at the cost of the usability, which is forcing users to choose between protection and productivity. And Wayland basically calls the 40 years of tools that have existed before them legacy tools and expects you just to adapt. And I very much dislike this stance fundamentally, especially as it's a totally a false dichotomy. And what I mean by that is, like, when someone presents only two options, like as if they're mutually exclusive and the only choices that are actually available, when in reality, alternatives do exist, or both things could be achieved simultaneously. In this case, Wayland advocates claim that you have to basically choose between security or functionality, ignoring that you could design a system that provides both, which is exactly what XLibre is attempting to prove. And it promises a third path, claiming that they'll retrofit modern security into Xorg's architecture. And if there's anyone that can actually do it, it's going to be this guy. Whether they can deliver actually remains to be seen, but the attempt really matters because competition drives innovation and monopolies breed complacency, basically. Their stated goals include implementing X namespace for better security isolation and potentially adding HDR support, features that Xorg users have basically wanted for years and never got. The fight represents everything wrong with modern open source. Corporations infiltrate products, they stack governance boards, then steer development toward their business interests. Red Hat, for example, wants Wayland because it fits their actual little twisted corporate enterprise model, which is locked down and controlled and predictable and, most of all, profitable. And they employ many of Wayland's core developers and shape its direction through direct funding. And the coordinated assault on Xorg follows a very familiar and similar pattern. First, they stop maintaining the actual thing while claiming it's a legacy, and then they pressure distributors to drop support. Finally, they memory hole anyone who resists. This is a very classic embrace, extend, and extinguish technique or tactic that exists. I'd like to know if you're familiar with this. Tell me in the comments if you've heard of this before, as it would really be great to see like an indicator of how successful they actually are at executing this kind of attack. Embrace, extend, extinguish was Microsoft's documented strategy in the 90s. Like, this isn't a fictional thing. First, support a competing standard. That's the embrace part. Then add proprietary features that break the compatibility. And here's the second step, the extend part. Then use market dominance to kill the original, which is the death blow. And that is the part, can you guess it? Right, it's the extinguish part. And they did this with Java, with Visual J++, to extend web standards with Internet Explorer, and to Kerberos authentication, each time pretending to support open standards while actually subverting them to create vendor lock-in. IBM basically pioneered using technology for authoritarian control with punch cards back in the 40s. Microsoft formalized this into the embrace, extend, extinguish playbook in the 90s, and now IBM is kind of running both strategies through Red Hat, like they're following a corporate villain handbook, I guess. And XLibre's existence in general threatens this narrative. And even if it fails technologically, it exposes the corporate manipulation. Users deserve choice, not forced migrations. The free software movement was built on alternatives, not mandates from companies playing kingmaker, right? Like, every fork kind of fractures and breaks their control. And with that comes a lot of power from the individual, as every alternative that's presented dilutes their power, and every choice they remove kind of exposes that agenda. So first, you need to understand your threat model. And if you're handling sensitive data or operating in a hostile environment, Wayland security improvements matter more than convenience. So make the switch and adapt to your workflow. But if you depend on X11 features for, say, productivity or whatever, start planning your exit strategy. Test your tools on Wayland now, and or alternatively, you could find alternatives. Or consider supporting XLibre's development. The window for smooth transitions is actually closing fast. Most importantly, pay attention to who controls your software stack. When corporations coordinate to take out alternatives, users lose. Support projects that maintain independence. Contribute to forks that preserve choice, and call out manipulation when you see it. Document corporate attacks and inform people when you can, because they count on your silence to actually succeed. Corporate interests now kind of dictate development to some extent regarding development priorities. Red Hat's, you know, nuclear response shows that they view users' choice more as a threat to their actual business model, and they should, because it really is. So the moment we actually stop fighting for alternatives is the moment that Linux becomes just another corporate product with a penguin logo. So keep your system secure, keep your options open, and your middle finger ready for anyone who tries to dictate how you are going to use your own computer. They think they own Linux now, so in turn, it's time to prove them wrong. In any case, thank you for watching to the end, and I'll see you in the next video.